Technologies, visto il decreto del rettore dell'Università degli Studi di Siena, repertorio numero 461-2020, protocollo numero 52533 del giorno 11 marzo 2020, che autorizza la modalità di svolgimento a distanza della prova finale e della proclamazione, consapevole delle sanzioni penali richiamate dall'articolo 76 del DPR 28 dicembre 2000, numero 445, in caso di dichiarazioni mendaci e di formazione e uso di atti falsi, dichiara di accettare lo svolgimento della prova finale in modalità telematica, che durante lo svolgimento della prova medesima non utilizzerà nessuno strumento di ausilio, che nel locale in cui si trova non sono presenti persone di supporto. San Bartolomeo in Galdo, 14 settembre 2021.
Grazie. Allora, se puoi condividere lo schermo con la tua presentazione.
Allora, il link è arrivato, quindi potete nella chat.
Posso? Ok, posso un attimo inviare il link?
Sì.
Sì. Allora, dicevo, la prima candidata è Carmen Apicella, il relatore professor Iannelli, il correlatore la dottoressa Fox, il controrelatore il professor Santoro.
Ok, ci sono. Lo presento?
Sì, vai.
Si vedono le slide.
Sì.
The title of my thesis is the prophage fee to entry, which encodes an asset like system responsible for increased mutagenesis in Streptococcus pneumoniae. The term asset responsible was first introduced in the 70s by Radman. This system consists of multiple factors promoting the integrity of DNA, as well as error-prone factors allowing for survival and continuous replication upon extensive DNA damage at the cost of elevated mutagenesis. Two proteins play a key role in the regulations of SS response, which are LEX-A and REC-A. During normal condition, LEX-A acts as a transcription suppressor, so it blocks the SS genes. But when there is a DNA damage, REC-A binds to the single-strand DNA filament and is converted from an inactive into an active form. When it is converted into an active form, can cause the self-cleavage of LEX-A, so there is the activation of SS genes and so of the SS system. Bacteria of the genus Streptococcus have long been considered to lack an SS response. But Streptococcus uris, a chromosomal damage inducible cassette responsible for the activations of SS response following the UV light exposure, was characterized. This cassette contained four genes coding for a LEX-A-like regulator, HGIR, the DNA polymerase UMC, and two hypothetical proteins. Other Streptococcus species, such as Streptococcus agalactiae, Pyogenes, Mitis, and others, have been found to carry this SS-like cassette. But in Streptococcus pneumoniae, SS-like response has not been reported. P1207.3 of Streptococcus pyogenes, which carries the macrolide-fluxo-resistant genes, MAPA and MSRD, and an SS-like cassette homologous to the cassette of Streptococcus uveris. This cassette is formed by six different overreading frames from the ORF6 to ORF11, and among them, there are ORF11 gene product that is homologous to the HGIR LEX-A-like transcriptional repressor. The ORF8 is that is homologous to UMC, of 17 products, which is homologous to the ULD-like protein and homolog of UMD. UMD and UMC are a component of the polymerase PI that is involved in a process of bypass and repair of errors. The aim of this thesis was to investigate whether the presence of a phage leads to the activation of an SOS-like response in Streptococcus pneumoniae, known to lack the SOS response. So the phage was transferred from Streptococcus pyogenes original host to Streptococcus pneumoniae R6 strain, which is an X-class strain, so it contained the mismatch repair system, which is a system important for repairing the mismatch-based pairs. Three esogenic R6 strains were constructed, one that not carried the phage, one strain that carried the phage, and another strain that carried the phage but is devoid of the cassette. The activations of the SOS-like response was investigated by measuring the survival and mutation rates upon exposure to both chemical and physical stresses, such as mitomycin C and UVC light. UV survival was carried out using a Perlab MicroVC LED instrument using a wavelength of 265 nanometers. This instrument is a compact system with interchangeable USB UVC LED and a dimming control, and also a system made of an instrument support and swappable and outwearable mini plates was a three-dimensional design and printed with nylon 12. The cells were plated after exposure to different UV frequencies from 0 to 6400, and then UV survival was calculated as a ratio between cell viability over radiated and not irradiated cultures. Whereas fluctuation tests were used to determine the mutation rates in absence and presence of UVC light and of mitomycin C, which was added at the early exponential phase. Approximately 1 per 10 elevated to 5 CFU of bacteria were inoculated in a set of 13 dependent tubes containing 5 ml of TSP. Among them, 10 tubes with the R6 derivative strain devoid of the phage, 10 tubes with the strain carrying the phage, and 10 tubes with the strain carrying the phage but devoid of the cassette. Cultures were grown at 37 degrees until the exponential phase, and then the rifampicin-resistant mutants were assessed by plating, and determinations of the mutation rate was performed using the R-package R-Salvador. Comparison of the UVC light survival of the three strains show an increased resistance of FR173 carrying the prophage. So, how we can see in the picture, it is reported with the green line. Compared to the control strain FR172 in black, not carrying the phage, and the control strain FR174 in red, carrying a recombinant phage with the SOS-like cassette deleted. Whereas, upon exposure to UVC light and mitomycin C, the strain carrying the phage show a significant increase in the mutation rate to rifampicin, whereas no significant increase was observed in the other two control strains, so in the strain wild type and the strain in which the cassette is deleted. The presence of a phage with the SOS-like cassette resulted in an increase of both survival after UVC light exposure and mutation rate upon mitomycin C and UVC light treatment, whereas no significant increase was observed in absence of the SOS-like cassette. In conclusion, we demonstrated that phage not only leads to drug resistance, but also carries a functional SOS-like cassette responsible for an SOS-like response in Streptococcus pneumoniae. Since this phage carries both antibiotic-resistant genes and a functional SOS-like cassette, it represents a great opportunity to study the mechanisms underlying the interplay between resistance and increased mutagenesis following the SOS response activation. It will be also interesting to study the effect of UVC light and other disinfection methods by identifying and characterizing the genes involved in this kind of responses. I want to thank to Professor Iannelli, Pozzi and Santoro, the Dr. Fox, and all the components of Lab of Molecular Microbiology and Biotechnology. Thank for your attention.
Okay, thank you. We can start the discussion. Professor Santoro, questions, comments?
So, in the results, you showed that the strain carrying the phage has an increased mutation rate, both induced by mitomycin and ultraviolet light.
Yeah.
But Upilite induces more mutations than mitomycin C. Have you thought about this? Do you have an explanation for this phenomenon? So UV more mutation than mitomycin C?
Yes, maybe because in the case of UVC light, there is neither a quantity of mutation that can carry out, and this is due to the fact also that when there is a UV light exposure, there is the formation of dimers of pyrimidines. And also there is a higher frequency of transversions and other type of mutations.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Other questions? Okay, thank you. We can move to the next candidate, Filipponi Calorina.
Yes.
Ci leggi la dichiarazione, per favore?
Sì. Sottoscritta Carolina Filipponi, matricola numero 095821, iscritta al corso di laurea magistrale in Medical Biotechnologies, visto il decreto del rettore dell'Università degli Studi di Siena del giorno 11 marzo 2020, autorizza la modalità di svolgimento a distanza della prova finale della proclamazione, consapevole delle sanzioni penali richiamate dall'articolo 76 del DPR 28 dicembre 2000, numero 445, in caso di dichiarazioni mendaci di formazione o uso di fatti falsi. Dichiara di accettare lo svolgimento della prova finale in modalità telematica, che durante lo svolgimento della prova medesima non utilizzerà nessuno strumento di ausilio, che nel locale in cui si trova non sono presenti persone di supporto. Rosignano Marittimo, 14.09.2021.
Allora, il relatore è il professor Lai, il correlatore è il professor Zazzi, il controrelatore è la professoressa Ciabattini. Puoi condividere il tuo schermo?
Sì.
Per favore.
Ok. Can you see the slides?
Yes.
Okay. So, COVID pandemic has created a public health crisis in the last 2 years. COVID-19 symptoms include fever, cold, and dyspnea. Dyspnea may further develop into acute respiratory syndrome or multiple organ failure. These symptoms are mainly due to SARS-CoV-2 infection, but also to immune overactivation. SARS-CoV-2 belongs to the family of coronaviruses, which is a wide family of envelope positive sense single-stranded RNA viruses. The viral particle is composed of the nucleocapsid protein associated with the viral RNA, envelope and membrane protein, which are mainly involved in the assembly of the viral particle, and the spike protein, which mediate the entrance of the viral particle into the host cell. Currently, COVID-19 management consists in both prevention and symptomatic treatment. Actually, the vaccination is the best option in order to prevent SARS-CoV-2 infection, but the high mutation rates in SARS-CoV-2 replication cycle can create new variants, and these new variants may be induced a reduced response by the approved vaccine. So approved vaccine might need further reformulation in order to neutralize new variants. The other treatment option is the symptomatic treatment, which are mainly based on anti-inflammatory drugs that aim to decrease the severe inflammation, but blocking the immune response during viral infections might be beneficial for viral replication. For this reason, our aim was to develop a new drug for SARS-CoV-2 treatment, which is able to block the viral replication, but also limit the excessive inflammatory response, which is associated with lung injury, but also with the high mortality rate of SARS-CoV-2 infection. For this reason, we have studied the acyl-ethanolamide hydrolyzing acid amidase inhibitor, also known as NAT inhibitor, And Na is an N-terminal cysteine hydrolase, which catalyzes the hydrolytic inactivation of palmitoyl ethanolamide. The reducing levels of Na create an increase in the palmitoyl ethanolamide levels, and PEA exerts important anti-inflammatory activity by binding to its receptor PPAR-alpha. Na inhibition leads to the activation of different pathways which may exert antiviral activity. The first pathway we have analyzed is the reduction of inflammation, which leads to the lung injury associated to SARS-CoV-2 infection. The second one is the induction of autophagy. So, considering that SARS-CoV-2 reduces the autophagic flux, the induction of the autophagy may reduce SARS-CoV-2 ability to replicate. The third pathway we have analyzed is the lipid droplet degradation, or the limit in lipid droplets formation. SARS-CoV-2 indeed seems to increase the number of lipid droplets in infected cells, so reducing this number, we may reduce SARS-CoV-2 ability to replicate. We starting analyze if Na may localize and may be active in these three pathways I mentioned before. So we starting analyzing the autophagic flux through the a transfection using an LC3 RFP GFP plasmid, in which the overlapping of green and red fluorescence stands for autophagosome, and only the red fluorescence stands for autolysosome. Then we marked the Na enzyme, and we found that Na is localized in both autophagosomes and autolysosome, suggesting that it may co-localize with SARS-CoV-2. In addition, we starting evaluate if Na ablation decreases SARS-CoV-2 replication. And in order to do that, we use the HU87 cells, and we modified them in order to create Na knockout cells. And we modified them using a CRISPR-Cas9 system, creating random mutations. We performed the time point quantitative real-time PCR on supernatant in order to evaluate the amount of SARS-CoV-2 genome, but also we performed a Western blot analysis evaluating the spike protein of SARS-CoV-2 in HU87 cells and in non-knockout cells. We found that HU87 non-knockout cells decreased by 5 times the amount of SARS-CoV-2 viral particle in the supernatant, but also in cell lysate compared to wild-type cells. After that, we starting evaluate if Na inhibition exerts the same antiviral activity as Na ablation. In order to do that, we performed the treatment using 4 different concentrations of our Na inhibitor, and we used the concentration starting from 3 micromolar to 30 micromolar, and the treatment was administered 15 minutes before infection, and then added again every 24 hours. We performed the same analysis as before in order to confirm the results, and we performed the real-time quantitative real-time PCR on supernatant taken from cells 48 hours after SARS-CoV-2 infection, and Western blot analysis analyzing the nucleocapsid protein of SARS-CoV-2. We found that HU87 cells treated with Na inhibitor decreased by 2 times the amount of SARS-CoV-2 viral particle in the supernatant and in cell lysate compared to untreated and infected cells. After that, we evaluated the mechanism of antiviral activity by the analysis of the induction of beta oxidation, which is one pathway which is activated by Na inhibition. On the right side of the screen, you can see a 3D representation of HU87 cells treated with oil red. We have analyzed the number of lipid droplets per cell in non-knockout cells compared to HU87 wild-type cells. And we found that non-knockout cells have a reduced number of lipid droplets, suggesting the possible limitation of SARS-CoV-2 replication. In order to evaluate, to find the mechanism which activate this beta oxidation, we performed the analysis of gene expression of the PPAR-alpha receptor. receptor, and we found that it activates and overexpress different genes involved in beta oxidation. So in conclusion, we can say that beta oxidation and lipid droplets dismantle are active in the absence of NAD. The last mechanism of antiviral activity we have analyzed is the induction of autophagy. This was analyzed using transmission electron microscopy, and we first analyzed the number of vacuoles per cell in HU87 cell compared to nanocalled cells. And we found that nanocalled cells have an increased number of vacuoles in cells compared to the wild type. In addition, we found that SARS-CoV-2 was located within these vacuoles, and in order to evaluate the nature of these vacuoles, we performed an immunogold LC3 assay, and we found that these vacuoles are mainly involved in the autophagic process. In addition, we can say that nanocalled cells increases by 3 times the amount of LC3 positive vacuoles, suggesting an increasing in the autophagy. And this is evident in the panel C and D, comparing the black and red columns. In addition, we found that SARS-CoV-2 infection decreases the autophagic flux. And this is can be seen in the same C and D graph, comparing the black columns. So in conclusion, we may say that NAD ablation and NAD inhibition reduce SARS-CoV-2 replication, inducing activation of autophagic flux, beta oxidation, and lipid droplets degradation. For this reason, NAD inhibitor has the potential to become an effective viral therapy against SARS-CoV-2 by blocking the viral replication, but also limiting the excessive immune responses, which are associated to the high mortality rates of SARS-CoV-2 infection. So I want to thank Dr. Michele Lai and all his team, and Prof. Francesco Fornai and Paola Lenzi for the transmission electron microscopy, and Prof. Maurizio Zazzi from the University of Siena.
Okay, thank you. Questions? Professoressa Ciabattini.
Yes, thank you for your interesting presentation. I was wondering if beyond the mechanism that you have shown about the activity of these NA, if you have also studied the impact of NA inhibition on the cytokine production, especially on the inflammatory cytokine production.
We started to analyze this pathway, but we know from literature that the increasing level of palmitoyl ethanolamide stimulate the limited cytokine production, and in addition, we found that it stimulates also the expression of genes involved in anti-inflammatory pathways. So basically, we already know that cytokine production is limited.
Indirectly.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Other questions? Okay, thank you. Allora, la prossima candidata è Caterina Lepre, sì. Il relatore è la professoressa Scheggi, il correlatore è la professoressa Gambarana, il controrelatore è la professoressa Antonini. Cortesemente ci puoi leggere la dichiarazione?
La sottoscritta Lepre Caterina Claudia, matricola 096607, iscritta al corso di laurea magistrale in Medical Biotechnology, visto il decreto del rettore dell'Università di Siena, degli studi di Siena, repertorio numero 461-2020, protocollo numero 5253-3 del giorno 11 marzo 2020, che autorizza la modalità di svolgimento a distanza della prova finale della programmazione, consapevole delle sanzioni penali richiamate all'articolo 76 del DPR 28 dicembre 2000, numero 445, in caso di dichiarazioni mendaci o di formazione o uso di atti falsi, dichiara di aver partecipato alla seduta di laurea il giorno 14 settembre 2021 della sessione di settembre dell'anno accademico 2019-2020 per il conseguimento del titolo finale e prende atto della valutazione della votazione finale con le quali è stato proclamato dottoressa magistrale in Medical Biotechnology, CESA, 14 settembre 2021.
Bene, se puoi presentare.
Vedete?
Chiudiamo i microfoni, per favore.
My thesis work is focused on the possible protective role of neurosteroids on the development of levodopa-induced dyskinesias in a rodent model of Parkinson's disease. The Parkinson's disease we know is a neurodegenerative disorder that mostly interests the structure of the basal ganglia, so the substantia nigra, the striatum, the globus pallidus. And the principal symptoms are the tremor, the bradykinesia, the rigidity that are due to the degeneration of dopaminergic neurons in the substantia nigra pars compacta, that is a consequence of the loss of neurotransmitter dopamine in the dorsal striatum. In fact, in normal condition, the dopamine is able to interact with the two main subclasses of dopamine receptor and controls different motor and non-motor functions. Instead, in Parkinson's disease condition, the dopamine is present in low concentration and is leading to movement disorders. The best treatment approved for the Parkinson's disease is the levodopa, that is a precursor into the dopamine synthesis, usually administered together with benzerazide or carbidopa, two important inhibitors of the dopa decarboxylase, that is the enzyme that converts the levodopa into dopamine in the peripheral tissue. And these two inhibitors inhibit the activity of the enzyme in order to allow to levodopa to reach the brain in sufficient concentration and carry out its therapeutic effect. In fact, the levodopa is able to restore the transmission from the substantia nigra to the striatum nucleus through the activation of the dopamine receptor, also controlling the typical symptoms of the Parkinson. But on the other hand, the chronic levodopa treatment seems to be related to the chronic stimulation of the dopamine receptor, leading to the appearance of other motor complications that are the levodopa-induced dyskinesias or LIDD. The molecular mechanism that characterizes LIDD is still unclear, but it seems that the dopamine D1 receptor is sensitized as a consequence of the loss of dopamine, and this is increased by the chronic levodopa treatment, leading to the alteration into the D1 receptor signaling pathways involving DAP32 and ERK. At the same time, it seems also that the chronic levodopa treatment stimulates the release of the brain-derived neurotrophic factors from the corticostriatal neurons, leading to interaction with its receptor, the TRKB receptor, that causes impairment in the trafficking and internalization. In fact, the dopamine D3 receptor is thought to be upregulated, and this increases the levels of membrane-bound dopamine D1 receptor, leading to the formation of specific heteromeric complexes between D1 and D3 receptors. Among the novel therapeutic agents that may reduce the appearance of the LIDD, a promising role seems to be played by the neurosteroids. The neurosteroids are also our choice because we've previously conducted in our laboratory a study in which using the 5-alpha-reductase inhibitors such as finasteride and dutasteride, there is a significant anti-dyskinetic effect in the rat model of Parkinson's disease. But finasteride and dutasteride seem to be related to different side effects. For this reason, we focused on neurosteroid, in particular on PREG, that is a precursor in neurosteroid synthesis, because it also exerts neuroprotective effects and therapeutic properties in dopamine-related disorders. So, the aims of this work were to analyze whether the long-term PREG administration prevented the formation of D1 and D3 receptor heteromeric complexes and the development of LIDD. Whether the long PREG administration normalized the D1 receptor signaling, analyzing the phosphorylation levels of DARPA32 and ERK12, and whether the long-term PREG administration is able to blunt the increased BDNF levels after the chronic levodopa treatment. First of all, was recreated the models by using a specific neurotoxin that is injected in the middle forebrain bundle stereotaxically. After 3 weeks, we evaluate the lesion using a stepping test. Then the rats were divided in 4 groups, one of which is the control group. Instead, the other one started the treatment with the levodopa. After 43 weeks, we evaluate the abnormal involuntary movement, and then we perform the tissue dissection. Our frozen samples are then subject to different techniques. Among them, we use the immunoprecipitation with DNA beads for the analysis of the expression levels of the heteromeric complexes. That is followed by electrophoresis on polyacrylamide gel and then by Western blotting. But these two last techniques were also used for the analysis of expression levels of dopamine D1 and D3 receptors and for the phosphorylation levels of ERK and dark matter tissue. So after the analysis, we obtain the result that can be divided in behavioral and neurochemical result. From a behavioral point of view, we evaluated abnormal involuntary movement in 4 different experimental groups. And as we can see in the blue column, the rats that were treated with the levodopa clearly developed dyskinesias compared to the control group. Instead, the treatment with the PREG and DUTA concurrently to the levodopa administration blunted the increased development of dyskinesias. So PREG resulted to be useful in reducing the appearance of lead. Instead, from a neurochemical point of view, first were analyzed the expression levels of the heteromeric complexes, and always, as we can see in the blue column, the rats treated with the levodopa clearly showed increased levels of these heteromeric complexes compared to the control group. Instead, the treatment with the PREG and DUTA concurrently to levodopa administration reduced the formation of these heteromeric complexes. In order to understand if the formation of these complexes is related to the levodopa treatment or not, I also analyzed the expression levels of the single dopamine D1 and D3 receptors. But from our analysis, the result did not evidence significant differences among the different experimental groups. Then I analyzed the phosphorylation levels of ERK12 and DARPA32 in order to understand if PREG is able to reduce the abnormality in the dopamine D1 signaling pathways. And in both cases, always represented by the blue column, the rat treated with the levodopa clearly showed increased levels of phosphorylation of DARPA32 and ERK compared to the control group. Instead, the rat treated with the PREG and DUTA, that concurrently received the levodopa, showed increased levels of phosphorylation of ERK and DARPA32. Then I also analyzed the expression levels of brain-derived neurotrophic factors in order to understand if changes in its concentration are related to the appearance of a lead. But from our result, we can see that there aren't significant differences among the different experimental groups, even if the rat treated with the levodopa, that is the blue column, showed increased levels of BDNF respect to the control groups. So in conclusion, the result of this study demonstrated that repeated PREG administration concurrently to levodopa is able to reduce the development of lead in a rat model of Parkinson's disease via reducing the formation of heteromeric complexes between the D1 and D3 receptors and via normalizing the D1 receptor signaling pathways. And all this lays the foundation for future study in order to better understand the rules of neurosteroid in Parkinson's disease. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you. Professoressa Medaglini.
Yes. Thank you for a very clear presentation and the well written thesis. I have a curiosity. You have mentioned the thesis that PREG has been tested in several clinical studies. Can
yes.
you briefly summarize what type of studies, what and has been shown its safety? Can you summarize what studies have been conducted in humans on this?
In other cases?
What we know about the safety.
Yes, the PREG is an important neurosteroid that is able to protect and effect and exert different neuroprotective effect in the brain. In fact, it is involved such as the other neurosteroids in the transmission of the neural signal, in the protection of the neurons, and also for the formation of new synapses. So it is exerted as a neuroprotective rule.
And it has been shown to be safe in all these clinical trials.
Yes, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Other questions? Grazie. La prossima candidata e Monetta Annalisa. Il relatore è il professor Giordano, la correlatrice è la dottoressa Condelli e il controrelatore è il professor Lai. Ci puoi leggere gentilmente la dichiarazione? Io non la sento.
No, non ti sentiamo.
Non la sentiamo, attivi il microfono. È attivato?
Provi a sollevare il volume. Sì, sente pochissimo.
Così mi sentite?
Un po' meglio.
Un po' meglio. Prova a leggere, vediamo che si sente.
La sottoscritta Annalisa Monetta, matricola numero 094905, iscritta al corso di laurea in Medical Biotechnologies, visto il decreto del rettore dell'Università di Siena del giorno 11 marzo 2020, che autorizza la modalità di svolgimento a distanza della prova finale e della proclamazione, consapevole delle sanzioni penali in caso di dichiarazioni mendaci di formazione o uso di atti falsi, dichiara di accettare lo svolgimento della prova finale in modalità telematica, che durante lo svolgimento della prova medesima non utilizzerà nessuno strumento di ausilio, che nel locale in cui si trova non sono presenti persone di supporto. Raganda, 14 settembre 2021.
Bene, grazie. Condividi il video e lo schermo.
Vedete lo schermo?
Sì, perfetto.
The title is Novel Epigenetic Drivers of Drug Resistance Linked to Gene Expression Modulation in Metastatic Colorectal Carcinoma. Colorectal cancer has become, over the past decades, one of the most common types of cancer, and despite advances in treatment, it accounts for 80% of all cancer deaths per years. It ranks third for males after prostate and lung cancer, and second for females after breast cancer. The risk of developing CRC is high between 60 and 17 years old, and less than 20% of cases occurs before age 50. Generally, tumor formation may take years to decay, and usually it starts with the uncontrolled proliferation of intestinal mucosal cells forming polyps. Then polyps enlarge, giving rise to benign adenoma, preneoplastic lesion on which almost all CRC arise. The thickening of epithelium then leads to the adenoma carcinoma sequence, and during the sequence, the stepwise accumulation of multiple genetic and epigenetic mutation leads to invasive and metastatic carcinoma. The etiology is still unknown, even if some epidemiological study highlighted the important part played by lifestyle factors, genetic factors, and non-hereditary factors. Focusing on the molecular profiling, there are three important pathways implicated in the CRC pathogenesis: chromosomal instability pathway, mixed light instability pathway, and CpG island methylator phenotype. The type of treatment is different and depends on several factors, as the size, the extension and location of the tumor, as well as the general condition of the patient. The first line of treatment is, in 80% of cases, surgery before proceed with radiotherapy and chemotherapy. The goal of chemotherapy is to eradicate micrometastasis, reduce tumor relapses, and increase cure rate. Current chemotherapy includes both single-agent regimen, like 5-fluorouracil, and or multiple agent regimens like FOLFOX, FOLFIRI or FOLFOXIRI. In addition, patients that present a specific genetic marker like EGFR mutation are eligible for the targeted therapy that employs the use of monoclonal antibodies as cetuximab, panitumumab or bevacizumab. Despite the different type of therapeutic strategies, the 5-year survival rate for metastatic colorectal cancer is only slightly over 12%, and the main cause of therapeutic failure is the onset of drug resistance. Drug resistance is a complex phenomenon ensued from changes at molecular levels and involving several biological processes. We know that CRC progression is driven not only by genetic mutation, but also by epigenetic mutation. An epigenetic mechanism can alter drug resistance by changing the state of condensation of chromatin. In fact, epigenetic aberrations are present in approximately 45 40% of CRC and can be subclassified in histone modification and DNA methylation. Since DNA methylation is a rapid event compared to genetic mutation, it seems that cancer cells use these mechanisms to rapidly adapt and trigger survival pathways, and this is particularly important in the acquired and de novo resistance to anti-cancer agent. So, considering that colorectal carcinogenesis is a multi-step process involving a crosstalk between gene mutation and epigenetic alteration, and that epigenetic hypermethylation phenomena were observed in genes involved in tumor suppression, cell cycle regulation, and induction of apoptosis, this study has explored the hypothesis that DNA epigenetic methylation may have a prognostic role in metastatic colorectal cancer. So, how was structured our study? As first step, global methylation profile were comparatively analyzed in our course of primary resistance and drug-sensitive tumors to obtain the different methylation profile. Then, to restrict the list of different differentially methylated genes to those that are functionally methylated genes, gene expression and methylation data were taken from 33 metastatic colorectal cancer from the TCA gene. Then the analysis on TCGA and house court was evaluated to study the prognostic value of the identified functionally methylated genes. And finally, the expression of statistically significant genes were evaluated in two independent irinotecan and oxaliplatin CRC cell line. So our in-house cohort was formed by 24 metastatic colorectal cancer, primary resistance to FOLFOX and FOLFIRI in combination or not with molecular target agent. And 12 drug-sensitive metastatic colorectal carcinoma were used as control to obtain the different methylation profile. The result showed a remodeled methylation status in the FOLFOX and FOLFIRI subgroups. Since gene promoter methylation is the main marker in the gene expression modification, in the subsequent analysis, only genes with methylation modification in promoter region were used. We next questioned if the differentially methylated genes were also functionally methylated genes, with a methylation profile consistent with a gene expression profile. Since we could not obtain the gene expression from in our course due to the poor amount and quality of RNA, this issue was addressed using 33 metastatic colorectal carcinoma from the TCGA database. As first, the methylation of the TCGA and house cohort were intersected to obtain two differentially methylated genes in the FOLFOX and FOLFIRI. Then, from the analysis of gene expression and methylation TCGA COAD and house dataset, we obtained 741 functionally methylated genes. In the subsequent bioinformatic analysis, applying different stringent filters, this list was first restricted to 8 and 20 hypermethylated genes, and then these were further restricted to 5 and 4 genes. After this, the combination of the 5 and 4 functionally methylated genes give us the signatures of 8 functionally methylated genes. Once obtaining the signatures, it was used in the hierarchical clustering analysis on the TCGA, and it separated patients in two well-defined cohorts of 22 hypomethylated and 11 hypermethylated. And a similar cluster was obtained in in-house FOLFOX and partially in FOLFIRI dataset. Moreover, combining the in-house FOLFOX and FOLFIRI dataset, a similar clustering was obtained. In order to evaluate the prognostic relevance of this signatures, a long-run test was performed on the TCGA and in-house dataset using the two previously obtained cluster, and also in this case, the data confirmed that cohorts with the hypermethylation status of the genes present a shorter survival compared with the cohorts with hypomethylation of the signatures. So the data confirmed that the signatures discriminate between metastatic colorectal patients with good hypomethylated tumors and poor hypermethylated tumor prognosis. The good and poor prognosis were further characterized respect to the clinical and biological profile using gene expression on a TCGA. CGA. Clinically, no difference were observed between good and poor prognosis. Instead, from the GSA enrichment analysis, two categories were enriched, the signaling pathway and the positional collection. In the signaling pathway, we identify the GSA analysis identify the Watanabe gene set that is composed by genes that discriminate between MSI and MSS colorectal cancer. A statistical analysis showed that in the Watanabe gene set, 19 were in common with our TCGA, and whose expression profile is consistent with division in good and poor prognosis cluster. Instead, in the second category, positional collection, the GSA the presence of downregulated genes on long arms of chromosome 13 and 20. In meantime, drug-resistant cell models chronically adapted to oxaliplatin and rinotecan were originated. These cells were the HCT116 and HT29. In a preliminary experiment, the apoptotic cell death was evaluated in cells exposed to oxaliplatin and rinotecan in combination or not with the demyelinating agent. And the apoptosis on the drug resistance and drug sensitive cells showed that the chronic exposure to the chemotherapeutic agent makes cells full sensitive to the oxaliplatin and irinotecan, and drug resistance is instead reverted with the presence of the demyelinating agent. The real time result confirmed this. In fact, 8 genes of the signatures were downregulated. In particular, 6 were downregulated in HT116 oxaliplatin resistant, and in both lines of HT29 oxaliplatin resistant and rinotecan, and 5 genes were downregulated in HCT116 rinotecan resistant cell line compared to the drug sensitive cells. So this data suggested that the 8 genes of the signatures were downregulated and are correlated with the onset of the drug resistance. And the main mechanism is of the downregulation is a methylation event. So in conclusion, we can say that the hypermethylation of specific set of genes may provide prognostic information to identify a subgroup of metastatic colorectal cancer with poor prognosis. The omics technology in tumor molecular profiling will improve the identification of new predictive and prognostic biomarkers, and an accurate molecular characterization will define personalized therapy in metastatic colorectal carcinoma patient. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you, Professor Lai. Questions?
So, well, you have my compliments. I mean, it's a very nice presentation. I have just one curiosity. How many cell lines have you used for your study? So your conclusions are based on how many types of cells? Do you have used like primary cells or cells from patients?
No, we used the cells that were chronically exposed to the irinotecan and oxaliplatin, but they don't derive from patient. They were taken from
one cell line. Just
two. HCT116 and HCT29 carcinoma cell line were used for this study.
So, and how can we use the amazing things that you have shown us to actually treat the patients? So what are the future perspectives?
In lab, next steps, we are after the identification of the 8 gene signatures, subsequent analyses are on the gene ontology, or in particular in drug resistant cells, in order to identify putative genes that may be implicated with the resistance to oxaliplatin and rinotecan. So there is a lot of work to do in the next future.
Okay, thank you.
Other questions? Okay, thank you. The next candidate is Salvan Menka, the supervisor, Professor Santoro, the second supervisor, Dr. Pinsauti, the co-examiner, Professor Iannelli. Can you read the declaration, please?
I, Menka Salvan, matricula number 098097, enrolled in the course Medical Biotechnology, considering the degree number 461-2020, protocol number 52533 of the Rector of the University of Siena, dated March 11, 2020, which authorizes the online procedure for the final exam, graduation and public proclamation, being aware that according to the Article 76 of the DPR 445-2000, false declaration, falsity in the public documents and use of false documents are punished according to the penal code and to the current special law on the subject. Declares I own responsibility to accept to perform my final exam via online procedure, and I will not take advantage of any external help during the performance of the exam. I mean, Gheolen Gianti Siana, 14 September 2021.
Okay, thank you. Can you share your desktop?
Is it visible?
Okay, thank you.
Honorable Faculty of University of Siena, a very good afternoon to all of you. I, Menkul Salwan, feel immense pleasure to share my topic, Complete Genome Sequence of Winkia Nui, formerly known as Actinomyces isolated form sample. Winkia Nui, formerly known as Actinomyces nui, was classified to the genus Actinomyces in 1994. And later upon reclassification of Actinomyces phylum in 2018, the genus Winkia was established. The general characteristics of Winkia nui are: it is non-filamentous, rod-shaped, gram-positive anaerobe, non-motile and produce circular smooth colonies, and does not produce sulfur granules like other Actinomyces species the form. It is occasionally uncommon pathogen. Different kinds of diseases are caused by Winkia nui. Abscess and infective atheroma are most common. Entomothelitis, urinary tract infection, bacteremia, and endocarditis are also observed in few cases. It is also associated with bacterial vaginosis. Winkia nui is an uncommon occasional pathogen which has been isolated in a wide range of clinical scenario and causing severe infection since 1990. But the frequency of reporting it as a pathogen has recently been increased because it caused both invasive and non-invasive diseases. In this master degree thesis, I determined the characterization of this strain, including its growth characterization, antibiotics susceptibility testing, and complete genome sequencing. Winkia nui was isolated from the blood culture and grown in BHI, very highly nutritious medium. The growth of Winkia nui was monitored according to three parameters: optical density of wavelength 590, the number of colonies forming unit, and the mean chain length. The growth curve was followed up to 15 hours after inoculum and after 24 to 48 hours. Aliquots were taken at the different phases of the growth curve to evaluate the cell count and the size of the cell clusters. The graph shows the typical growth curve of Winkia nui taking time on the x-axis and OD on the y-axis. The lag phase lasts about 3 hours, and the slow exponential phase with doubling time of about 100 minutes. Stationary phase after 8 hours, and then there is no evidence of lysis. At the end of exponential phase, the strain reach maximum OD 590 of about 0.3, which correspond to 1.28 into 10 raised to power 7 CFU. Average chain length was 4 to 5 cells. Antimicrobial susceptibility testing was done to check the sensitivity to 18 antimicrobial agent using a sensitizer gram-positive plate. For that, a few colonies were taken up, and then standard value of 0.5 microlent was prepared and then diluted in 1:100. And after that, transfer the pathogen to the MIG plate and 24-hour incubation, and then the antimicrobial susceptibility test was observed. This table shows the MIG value interpretation according to the UCAS criteria for gram-positive anaerobe. There are only four values are available according to the MIG interpretation. For others, there is no value available. For most of the antibiotic, no growth of Winkia nui could be observed even at the lowest concentration tested, suggesting that the strain is essentially susceptible to all the antibiotic tested. For DNA extraction, the enzymatic lysis protocol was followed, in which the culture was inoculated and incubated at 37 degrees and then resuspended in a raffinose buffer to avoid osmotic lysis. Then the lysis of the cell wall was done by using lysosome and followed by the production of protoplast. Protoplast was resuspended in the sterile distilled water and proteinase K. And after that, the purification of DNA was done by using twice the wash of CVAG. And by adding of isopropanol, it induced the nucleic acid precipitation. After getting the DNA extracted, next step is to check the quantity and quality of the DNA extracted. For quantity, I use the qubit 4 fluorometer. And the value was 3.93 microgram total DNA extracted. For sample purity, a nanophotometer device was used, manufactured by Implant using quartz COVID. The purity grade was assessed by looking at the value A260 by 280 and A260 by 230. The value of A260 by 280 was quite good, which shows no contamination with the protein, whereas A260 by 230 show little low value, suggesting that there is some carryover of chloroform or isopropanol from the extraction process. After checking the quantity and quality, next step is to measure the molecular weight of the genomic DNA according to the size and charge. Gel electrophoresis method was used, in which the TB buffer solution is used, and the gen ruler 1 KB plus DNA letter molecular marker was loaded on the 1 and 8 number, whereas on 5, 6 and 7, the lambda DNA marker was used in the concentration 100, 30 and 10 nanogram respectively, whereas on the number 2, 3 and 4, the Winkian UI sample was loaded at, on number 2, it was 1 microliter of the DNA sample, and on number 3 and 4, it was diluted for 1:10 and 1:20. The DNA obtained has a high molecular weight with fraction of DNA retained in the loading well. A smear can be seen from about 2.5 kb in length, and the traces of ribosomal RNA can also be observed. To sequence the whole genome, we use Oxford Nanopore technology. It is a combination of gene and engineering technology and computer aided technology, both time and cost effective, and enable the real time single molecule sequencing. It is based on the principle that biological nanopore embedded in the electrical resistant membrane where an ionic current flows. Analyte passed through the nanopore and suitable potential is applied across the membrane, and the measurement of alteration enables the identification of the nucleotide composition. The device used for nanopore technology is GridION X5. There are other kinds of devices also available for nanopore technology, like MinION for with single flow cell and PromethION containing 48 flow cell. Here in my project, we use GridION X5, which allows the sequencing of up to 5 flow cell at a time, concurrently or individually. It allows cost optimization and flexibility. The GridION integrated computer, 64 GB RAM, and support real-time analysis, while a GPU device further accelerates the analysis. The nanopore run is controlled by proprietary software Minno, provide real-time visualization and analysis of the sequence run. Minno offers the option to perform both sequencing and base calling simultaneously. For the sequencing process, the first step is library preparation, that is done by using the rapid sequencing kit protocol. The key feature of this protocol is the transpose mediate template cleavage, which is followed by the attachment of tags and adapter to the cleavage end, and after that loading of the library onto the spot on part of the flow cell, and followed by sequence run and data analysis. The raw nanopore fast 5 sequencing read were base call using the Guppy tool, and then the filtering read or removing the short read is done by the filtlong tool. Filter reads are then used for the genome assembly by using fly assembler, and if there are still some errors were there, then error correction is done by using the Medaka tool. Annotation of the coding sequence is done by using the tool PROCA, and the presence of virulence and putative antimicrobial resistance genes were determined by using the ABRICAT tool. After performing that analysis, we got the nanoplot summary statistics. So we got total sequence read more than 15,000 for the total length of more than 200 MB, mean read quality 11.1 and read length N50 for more than 42,000. More than 50 reads were obtained of length longer than 100 kb. The graph was obtained with the nanoplot and plot the read length. The graph shows the read length on the x-axis and the number of read on the y-axis. A considerable number of reads were around 100 bp. Read number had a peak around 25 kb and the tail of read around 100 kb indicate that the protocol was very efficient in generating some ultra long reads. The genome map is described here from outside to inside. The red color shows the genes in the forward strand, whereas the light blue color shows the gene in the backward strand. And into the next inner circle shows the CDS region where transfer RNA, ribosomal RNA, ribosomal RNA in black in color, whereas transfer RNA is in light gray color. Blue color shows the CRISPR domains. And the innermost circle shows light and dark green color of GCSQ. Chromosome contain more than 2 million base pair with 56.3% GC content. Genome annotation identify 23 under 55 genes with 2,292 CDS and 49 transfer RNA, 9 ribosomal RNA and 1 transfer messenger RNA. The complete type 1e CRISPR system identifying color dark blue containing genes Cas1 to Cas7 except Cas4. The CRISPR locus contain 34 direct repeat spaced by 33 spacer sequence which do not match any sequence in the CRISPR space database. No such detection of putative violence and AMR genes, but annotated CDS inspection identify 4 putative efflux pump genes associated with the multi-drug resistance 1 mate and 3 MFS transporter. Toxin antitoxin system of GenJ and YFQ family also identify, and some putative violence factor SOT-A and CATG genes are also identified. The Winkia Nui strain was essentially susceptible to all the tested molecule in accordance with the literature on actinomycetes. The genome sequencing presented here is the first complete genome sequence for Winkia Nui and will be a contribution to the characterization of this microorganism. Genome sequencing confirmed the absence of antibiotic resistant determinant. Genome was reconstructed with high accuracy using nanopore sequencing, which shows it is a mature technology to be used efficiently for microbial genomics. And at the last, I would like to thank the University of Siena and Department of Medical Biotechnology to provide me opportunity to do my master here. Being an international student, I am feeling very honored. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Why the Oxford nanopore sequencing is a mature technology for genome sequencing, according to you?
As nanopore sequencing technology provide very long reads, and which allow the closure of genome. And in this work, I demonstrated that it produced the coding sequences which does not exceed the expected number. So there is no frame shift mutation will be there, and the good assembly of genome will be there with the less error as expected. Like few years back, there were so many errors were expected in the nanopore sequencing, but now less. From the genome sequencing, we can evaluate that if there are less number of coding sequence, then there are less chances of frame shift mutation. So nanopore sequencing is very beneficial.
Okay, thank you. Other questions? Okay, thank you. L'ultimo candidato è Vasto La Serena.
Buon pomeriggio.
Relatore la professoressa Medaglini, il correlatore la professoressa Ciabattini, il controrelatore la professoressa Scheggi. Ci leggi la dichiarazione per favore?
La sottoscritta Vasto La Serena, matricola numero 095946, iscritta al corso di laurea magistrale in Medical Biotechnologies. Visto il decreto del rettore dell'Università degli Studi di Siena, repertorio numero 461-2020, protocollo numero 52533 del giorno 11 marzo 2020, che autorizza le modalità di svolgimento a distanza della prova finale della programmazione, consapevole delle sanzioni penali richiamate dall'articolo 76 del DPR 28 dicembre 2000, numero 445, in caso di dichiarazioni mendaci e di formazione o uso di atti falsi, dichiara di accettare lo svolgimento della prova penale in modalità telematica, che durante lo svolgimento della prova medesima non utilizzerà nessuno strumento d'ausilio, che nel locale in cui si trova non sono presenti persone di supporto. Pagani, 14 settembre 2021.
Grazie.
Can you see the slides?
Yes, thank you.
So my thesis work focused on the characterization of the spike-specific B-cell response following vaccination with the BNT162b2 mRNA vaccine against SARS-CoV-2, also known as the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine. The COVID-19, which is caused by the severe acute respiratory syndrome coronavirus 2, constitutes a public health emergency of international concern, as we experienced it in the last months. Since there are no current specific treatments against the disease, vaccines are considered the most effective approach to provide protection against SARS-CoV-2 infection. An incredible effort has been made in order to develop vaccine to reduce mortality and morbidity, and currently licensed mRNA vaccines against SARS-CoV-2 have demonstrated high efficacy and immunogenicity, but limited information is currently available on memory B and T cells generation and long-term persistence. The nucleic-based mRNA vaccines deliver the genetic information for the antigen rather than the antigen itself, like other commonly used. Generally, these vaccines are administered intramuscularly. Then the mRNA enters the cytoplasm of host cells and it's translated. After that, proteins can be released out of the host cells and can be taken up by dendritic cells, where they are processed and presented to T cells and B cells through the MHC class II pathway. Also, B cells can recognize the released proteins. These triggers a series of events that leads to a strong antigen-specific humoral and cellular immune response. The aim of the thesis was to characterize the immune responses induced by the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine in healthy subjects and its persistence up to 6 months after the vaccine administration. In order to do that, we evaluated the humoral response by ELISA and plasma samples and the spike-specific B cells and T cells responses by the multiparametric flow cytometry in peripheral blood mononuclear cell samples. In this slide, we can see the experimental design of the study. First of all, subjects were vaccinated with two doses, 3 weeks apart, following the protocol that was followed in Italy. Then blood samples were collected at different time points, particularly they were collected at day zero before vaccination, 7 days after the first dose, before the second dose, 7 days after the second dose, and then 3 months and 6 months after vaccination. Then we evaluated the humoral and cellular responses at different time points, as we can see in the table. In order to study the immune responses induced by vaccination, we separated blood using a Fickle gradient. Then we used the plasma to evaluate the antibody response, as already said, by ELISA, the enzyme-linked immune sorbent assay. And we used the PBMC samples to evaluate the B and T cell responses by multiparametric flow cytometry analysis. We have evaluated different surface markers in order to simultaneously, and flow cytometry allowed us to select cell population of interest and study them. So we evaluated the spike-specific antibody response at all time points. And we observed that spike-specific antibody titers peaked 7 days after the second dose, but the significant titers were still observed as far as 6 months after vaccination, even though there is a decline over time. Then we also evaluated the binding efficacy of the antibodies induced by the vaccine to bind to the Delta variant of the spike protein. And we saw that antibodies efficiently bound to the Delta variant of the spike protein. Taken together, this result demonstrates a robust induction of spike-specific humoral response, and it also lends confidence that this response can be effective against the Delta variant. This is one of the most concerning one among the currently emerged variants. Then we characterized the spike-specific B-cell response. In order to do that, we used a different surface marker. And as we can see in panel A, we used CD19 to gate on B cells, then spike to select only the SARS-CoV-2 specific B cells. And we observed that the total spike specific B cells were significantly increased after the second vaccination dose, and they were maintained significantly higher 6 months after vaccination. Then, as we can see in panel C, we use the CD38 and IgD in order to individuate plasma blast and memory B cells. And as you can see in the panel B, D, in the panels D and D, we also evaluated the expression of the Ig isotypes on memory B cells. So we observed that the average frequency of plasma blast was detected the 7 days after the second dose, according to the function of these cells, and also switched memory B cells increased over time after the second dose, always according to their function. Then we observed that there is an higher frequency of memory B cells expressing CD24 and CXCR5 6 months after vaccination. These two markers are markers of mature memory B cells. So this demonstrated that there is a persistence of memory B cells 6 months after vaccination. Then we also observed that the majority of spike-specific memory B cells expressed IgG, and only a low amount expressed IgM or IgA. This confirmed that the efficacy of the vaccine formulation to drive an extensive germinal center reaction that is probably due to a robust induction of a Th1 CD4 immune response. So we also characterized the CD4 CD8 cell response. And as you can see in panel B, we identified effector memory T cells using CCR7 and CD45 array, and we selected the follicular B helper T cells by using PD-1 and ICOS. We noticed a significant increase of follicular B helper T cells 7 days after the second vaccination, and this confirmed the role of CD4 T cells in driving the B cells B cell formation. Then, among activated CD8 T cells, we individuated that both HLA, DR, and PD-1 cells have a peak 7 days after the second dose and a decline 3 months after vaccination. These markers are markers of effector memory T cells, so they could be helpful in the following encounter with the antigen. In conclusion, mRNA and BNT162b2 vaccine elicits a strong immunological response with spike-specific IgG that persists at least 6 months after vaccination. And there is also an antigen-specific B-cell, a robust antigen-specific B-cell response that is induced at different time points following vaccination in accordance with their function. Finally, we also saw a consistent effector memory T cell response that is elicited by the mRNA vaccine. Of course, longer-term follow-up studies in vaccinated subjects are necessary to monitor the persistence of both the antibodies and the antigen-specific memory B and T cells in order to answer to the open question of the persistence of this vaccine. I would like to thank you to the Laboratory of Molecular Microbiology and Biotechnologies and Professor Donata Medaglini, my supervisor, and Dottoressa Annalisa Sombattini, my co-supervisor. Thank you for the attention.
Thank you, Professoressa Scheggi.
Non ci sentiamo.
La professoressa Scheggi.
Sorry. Okay, thank you, Serena. Your study is very interesting, and it may provide crucial information today to investigate, of course, the immune response following vaccination. If I understand well, you measured quite specific B cells upon vaccination. And you used several antigens, surface markers like CD27 or TH5 to identify specific subsets of cells elicited by vaccination. So, in your opinion, among them, which cell phenotype is more interesting in order to have an effective high quality immune response? And these are different phenotypes are associated with different function, longer half-life. There are differences between these cell phenotypes.
Yes, of course, the phenotype of the cells that we consider have different functions. I think that the most useful in the immune responses are the ones that we consider in this study. So plasma blast memory B cells and the TH1 follicular B helper T cells.
Okay, and it is possible to enhance, to increase a specific subset of these immune cells. Okay, probably not.
I think not.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Other questions? Okay, thank you. Now the students remain connected here and the committee move to another room. We will come back in a few minutes. Ci disconnettiamo da qui per favore tutti e andiamo di là. Eccoci qua. Allora, se ci siamo tutti, sembra di sì. Dottoressa Picella Carmen, c'è?
Sì, ci sono.
Dottoressa Carmen Apicella, la Commissione ha approvato il suo esame di laurea magistrale con punti 110 su 110 e lode e pertanto la proclamiamo dottoressa magistrale in Medical Biotechnologies. Complimenti e se ci leggi la dichiarazione di accettazione.
Grazie. La sottoscritta Carmen Apicella, matricola numero 094737, iscritta al corso di laurea magistrale in Medical Biotechnologies, visto il decreto del rettore dell'Università degli Studi di Siena, repertorio numero 461-2020, protocollo numero 52533 del giorno 11 marzo 2020, che autorizza la modalità di svolgimento a distanza della prova finale della proclamazione. Consapevole delle sanzioni penali richiamate dall'articolo 76 del DPR 28 dicembre 2000, numero 445, in caso di dichiarazioni mendaci e di formazione e uso di fatti fatti, dichiara di aver partecipato alla seduta di laurea del giorno 14 settembre 2021, della sessione di settembre dell'anno accademico 2019-2020, per il conseguimento del titolo finale e prende atto della valutazione e della votazione finale con le quali è stata proclamata dottoressa magistrale in Medical Biotechnologies. San Bartolomeo in Galdo, 14 settembre 2021.
Grazie e complimenti. La
Grazie.
dottoressa Carolina Filipponi,
Sì.
la commissione ha approvato il suo esame di laurea magistrale con la votazione di 110 su 110 e lode e pertanto la proclamiamo dottoressa magistrale in biotecnologie mediche, Medical Biotechnology. Ci puoi leggere per favore la dichiarazione?
Sì, la sottoscritta Carolina Filipponi, matricola numero 095821, iscritta al corso di laurea magistrale in Medical Biotechnologies, visto il decreto del rettore dell'Università degli Studi di Siena, repertorio numero 461-2020, del giorno 11 marzo 2020, che autorizza la modalità di svolgimento a distanza della prova finale della proclamazione. Consapevole delle sanzioni penali richiamate dall'articolo 76 del DPR 28 dicembre 2000, numero 445, in caso di dichiarazione mendace di formazione o uso di atti falsi, dichiara di aver partecipato alla seduta di laurea del giorno 14.09.2021 della sessione di settembre dell'anno accademico 2020-2021 per il conseguimento del titolo finale e prende atto della valutazione della votazione finale con le quali è stata proclamata dottoressa magistrale in Medical Biotechnologies. Signano Marittimo, 14.09.2021.
Grazie e complimenti. Dottoressa
Grazie.
Caterina Claudia Lepre,
Sì.
la Commissione ha approvato il suo esame di laurea magistrale con punti 110 su 110 e pertanto la proclamiamo dottoressa magistrale in biotecnologie mediche, Medical Biotechnology. Cortesemente, se ci puoi leggere la dichiarazione.
La sottoscritta Letre Caterina Claudia, matricola 096607, iscritta al corso di laurea magistrale in Medical Biotechnologies, visto il decreto del rettore dell'Università degli Studi di Siena, repertorio numero 461-2020, protocollo numero 52533 del giorno 11 marzo 2020, che autorizza la modalità di svolgimento a distanza della prova finale della proclamazione, consapevole delle sanzioni penali richiamate all'articolo 76 del DPR 28 dicembre 2000, numero 445, in caso di dichiarazioni mendaci di formazione o uso di atti falsi, dichiara di aver partecipato alla seduta di laurea il giorno 14 settembre 2021 della sessione di settembre dell'anno accademico 2019-2020 per il conseguimento del titolo finale e prende atto della valutazione della votazione finale con le quali è stata proclamata dottoressa magistrale in Medical Biotechnologies, CESA 14 settembre 2021.
Grazie e
Grazie.
complimenti. Dottoressa
Grazie.
Annalisa Monetta, la
Sì.
Commissione ha approvato il suo esame di laurea magistrale con punti 110 su 110 e lode e pertanto la proclamiamo dottoressa magistrale in biotecnologie mediche. Medical Biotechnology. Cortesemente, se ci
Sì.
puoi
La
leggere.
sottoscritta Annalisa Monitta, matricola numero 094905, iscritta al corso di laurea magistrale in Medical Technologies, visto il decreto del rettore dell'Università di Siena, repertorio numero 461-2020, protocollo numero 52533 del giorno 11 marzo 2020, che autorizza la modalità di svolgimento a distanza della prova finale della proclamazione, consapevole delle sanzioni penali richiamate dall'articolo 76 del DPR 28 dicembre 2000, numero 445, in caso di dichiarazioni mendaci, di formazione e uso di atti falsi, dichiara di aver partecipato alla seduta di laurea del giorno 14 settembre 2021 e alla sessione di settembre dell'anno accademico 2020-2021 per il conseguimento del titolo finale e prende atto della valutazione della votazione finale, con la quale è stata proclamata dottoressa magistrale in Medical Biotechnologies. Pietra Galla, 14 settembre 2021.
Grazie e complimenti. Dottor
Grazie.
Menka Salvan,
Yeah.
the committee has approved your thesis defense with the graduation of 95 out of 110. And then we proclaim you dottoressa magistrale in medical biotechnology. Can you read the declaration, please?
I then assigned Minka Salvan, matricula number 098097, enrolled in the course of medical biotechnology, considering the decree number 461-2020, protocol number 52533 of the Rector of the University of Siena, dated March 11, 2020, which authorizes the online procedure for the final exam, graduation, and public proclamation, being aware that according to the Article 76 of DPR 445-2000, false declaration, false in public documents, and the use of false document are punished according to the penal code and to the current special law on the subject. Under my own responsibility, I participated in the graduation exam on 14/9/21 during final degree exam session of the academic year 2020-21 for the achievement of final qualification. I accept the evaluation and the final marks with which I declared as master degree in medical biotechnology, Geolane Ghianti Siena, 14 September 2021.
Okay, thank you and congratulations. Dottoressa Serena Vastola? Sì. La commissione ha approvato il suo esame di laurea magistrale con punti 110 su 110 e lode. E pertanto la proclamiamo dottoressa magistrale in biotecnologie mediche, medical biotechnology. Cortesemente, se ci leggi la dichiarazione di accettazione.
La sottoscritta Vastola Serena, matricola 095946, iscritta al corso di laurea magistrale in Medical Biotechnologies, visto il decreto del rettore dell'Università degli Studi di Siena, repertorio numero 461-2020, protocollo numero 52533 del giorno 11 marzo 2020, autorizza la modalità di svolgimento a distanza della prova finale della proclamazione, consapevole delle sanzioni penali richiamate dall'articolo 76 del DPR 28 dicembre 2000, numero 445, in caso di dichiarazione mendace di commissione uso di atti falsi, dichiara di aver partecipato alla seduta di laurea del giorno 14 settembre 2021 della sessione di settembre dell'anno accademico 2020-2021 per il conseguimento del titolo finale, e prende atto della valutazione finale con le quali è stata proclamata dottoressa in Medical Biotechnology, Pagani, 14 settembre 2021.
Grazie e complimenti. Allora, di nuovo complimenti a tutti i neolaureati e ringrazio tutti i membri della commissione per la collaborazione.
Grazie a voi.
Grazie e
Complimenti.
alla prossima.
Complimenti a tutti. Arrivederci.
Non con gli studenti.
Complimenti, arrivederci.
Grazie. Sì.
Professore, tutto a posto?